going to discuss the NICE guideline about antenatal care for the uncomplicated pregnancy, and this guideline was published in March 2008. Okay, so we will discuss the important features of this guideline, because it's very difficult to read each and every point of this guideline. Okay, so let's go to the main points. Okay, introduction. The main point in introduction is that the ethos of this guideline is that pregnancy is a normal physiological process, and that as such any intervention offered should have known benefit and be acceptable to the woman. And what is the aim of this guideline? The guideline has been developed with the following aim. First of all, to offer information, best practice for the baseline clinical care of all pregnancies, and comprehensive information on the antenatal care of the healthy woman with an uncomplicated singleton pregnancy. Then it also provides evidence-based information for the use by the clinician and the pregnant woman to make decision about appropriate treatment in the specific circumstances. Now, what will this guideline complement? This guideline will complement the Children National Service Framework, England and Wales, which provides standard for service configuration with the emphasis on how care is delivered and by whom, including the issues of ensuring the equity of access to care for disadvantaged women and the women's views about service provision. Women-centered care. Okay, now how should women and the her family be treated? It's very important. Women and her family, and women, their partner and her family should always be treated with kindness, respect and dignity. The views, beliefs and the values of the woman and her partner and her family in relation to the care and that of the baby should be sought and respected all the times. Now, who should take the decision about the woman health? Women should have opportunity to make informed decision about their care and treatment, the partnership with their healthcare professionals. What is the importance of the good communication? Good communication between the healthcare professionals and the woman is essential, and it should be supported by the evidence-based written information and tailored to the woman's need. Now, antenatal information. What information should be given to the woman? Pregnant women should be offered information based on the current available evidence, together with the support to enable them to make informed decision about their care. And this information should include where they will be seen and who will undertake their care. Now, lifestyle consideration. Very important. How much vitamin D per day is required by the woman? All the women should be informed at the booking appointment about the importance of their own body and the baby's health for maintaining adequate vitamin D stores during the pregnancy and whilst breastfeeding. In order to achieve this, women should be advised to take a vitamin D supplement, 10 microgram of the vitamin D per day, as found in the Healthy Start multivitamin supplements. Women who are not eligible for the Health Start benefit should be advised where they can buy the supplements. And which women are at greater risk of the vitamin D deficiency? Particular care should be undertaken to inquire as to whether women at the greatest risk are following advice to take the daily supplements. These include women with a darker skin. Okay, secondly, those who have limited exposure to sunlight. Okay, those with a darker skin also have vitamin D deficiency, and those who have limited exposure to sunlight also have vitamin D deficiency. Now, screening for hematological conditions. Screening for sickle cell disease, thalassemia, should be offered to all the women as early as possible in the pregnancy, ideally by the 10 weeks. Okay, and the type of the screening depends upon the prevalence and can be carried out either in either primary or secondary care. Now, screening for fetal anomalies, there are some important points for that as well. Participation in the General Congenital Anomaly Register and the UK National Screening Committee approved audit system is strongly recommended to facilitate the audit of direction rates. The combined test, knuckle translucency, beta HCG, pregnancy associated with associated plasma protein A should be offered to screen for the Down syndrome between 11 and 13 plus 6 weeks. For the woman who book later in the pregnancy, the most clinically and cost-effective serum screening triple test, triple or quadruplet, should be offered between 15 and 20 weeks of gestation. Now, it's very important that detection or sensitivity of contraceptive test for Down syndrome is about 65%. Now, screening for clinical conditions. Screening for gestation diabetes using a risk factor is recommended in healthy population. At booking appointment, the following risk factor for gestation diabetes should be determined. First of all, body mass index more than 30 kg per meter square, previous macrosomic baby weighing 4.5 kg or more, previous gestation diabetes, family history of diabetes, family origin with a high prevalence of the diabetes, like South Asian, especially women whose country of family origin is India, Pakistan, or Bangladesh, Black Caribbean, Middle Eastern, specifically women whose country of family origin is Saudi Arabia, United Arab Emirates, Iraq, Jordan, Syria, Oman, Qatar, Kuwait, Lebanon, or Egypt. Women with any of these risk factors should be offered testing for gestational diabetes. Now, what antenatal information should be given? Antenatal information should be given to the pregnant woman according to the following schedule. At first contact with the healthcare profession, we should give advice regarding the folic acid supplementation, food hygiene, including how to reduce the risk of the food-acquired infection, lifestyle advice, including the smoking cessation and implication of the recreational drug use and alcohol consumption in the pregnancy, and all antenatal screening, including screening for hemoglobinopathy, the anomaly scan, and the screening for the Downey syndrome, as well as the risk and benefits of the screening test. We have to give information. We don't have to normally scan and screening for Down syndrome at this stage, but we have to give information at the early booking. Now, at the booking, ideally by the interaction with the patient. Now, at the booking, ideally by the 10 weeks. Booking is ideally by the 10 weeks. We have to check how the baby develops during pregnancy, nutrition, diet, including vitamin D supplementation for the women at the risk of vitamin D deficiency. Okay, and then exercise, including pelvic floor exercises, place of the birth, pregnancy care, mouthway, breastfeeding, including the workshops, participant led anesthesia classes, and further discussion of all the antenatal screening and discussion of the mental health issues. Now, before or at 36 weeks, breastfeeding information, including the technique and how good management practice that would help the woman succeed, such as detail and unisuffocate, baby friendly initiative. Okay, so at 36 weeks, we have to give information about breastfeeding. Secondly, preparation for the labor and birth, including information about coping with the pain and labor and birth plan, cognition of the active labor, care of the newborn, vitamin K supplementation, newborn screening test, postnatal self-care, awareness of the baby blue, and postnatal depression. At 38 weeks, we have to discuss the option of the management of the prolonged birth. This can be supported by the information such as the baby book. Okay, now what should be the quality of information given to the woman? Information should be given in form that is easy to understand and acceptable to the woman with additional needs such as physical, sensory, learning, disabilities, and to the pregnant woman who does not speak or read English. Information can be given in other forms such as audiovisual or touch screen technology. This should be supported by the written information. Now, pregnant women should be offered information based on the current available evidence together with the support to enable them to make informed decision about their care. And this information should include where they will be seen and who will undertake their care. At each antenatal appointment, healthcare professional should offer consistent information and clear explanation and should provide pregnant women with the opportunity to discuss their issues and ask the question. Pregnant women should be offered opportunities to attend participant-led antenatal classes, including the breastfeeding workshop. Now, women decision should be respected, even when this is contrary to the views of the healthcare professionals. Pregnant women should be informed about the purpose of any test before it is performed. The healthcare professionals should ensure the woman has understood information and has sufficient time to make an informed decision. The right of the woman to accept or decline tests should be made clear. Information about the antenatal screening should be provided in a setting where decision can take place. This may be in a group setting or one-to-one basis, and this should be done before the booking appointment. The information about antenatal screening should include balanced and accurate information about the condition being screened for. Then the provision and organization of the care. Who provide the care? Midwife-led models of the care should be offered to the woman with an uncomplicated pregnancy. Routine involvement of the obstetrician in the care of the woman with an uncomplicated pregnancy at scheduled time does not appear to improve the perinatal outcome compared with involving obstetrician when complication arises. Continuing of the care. Antenatal care should be provided by a small group of the healthcare professionals with whom the woman feels comfortable. And there should be continuity of care throughout the antenatal period. Then a system of the clear referral path should be established so that the pregnant women who require additional care are managed and treated by the professional specialist team when the problems are identified. Now, where should an antenatal appointment take place? Antenatal care should readily and easily accessible to all the women and should be sensitive to the needs of the individual women and the local community. The environment in which antenatal care appointment takes place should enable the woman to discuss the sensitive issues such as domestic violence, sexual abuse, psychiatric illness, and recreational drug. Now, documentation of the care is very important. The structured maternity record should be used for antenatal care. Maternity services should have a system in place whereby the women carry their own notes, case notes. A standardized national maternity record with an accurate minimum data set should be developed and used, and this will help the healthcare professional to provide the recommended evidence-based care to the pregnant woman. Now, frequency of the antenatal appointment is very important. That there should be 10 appointments should be made for the nulliparous woman, and for the woman who is parous and uncomplicated, a schedule of 7 appointments. So in uncomplicated pregnancies, 10 appointments in case of nulliparous and 7 appointments in case of the multiparous. And early in pregnancy, all the women should receive appropriate written information about the likely number, timing, and content of the antenatal appointments associated with the different options of the care, and should be given an opportunity to discuss their schedule with their midwife or doctor. Each antenatal appointment should be structured and have focused content. Longer appointments are needed early in the pregnancy to allow comprehensive assessment and discussion, and where possible, the appointment should incorporate the routine test and investigation to minimize the inconvenience to the woman. Okay, now gestation age at assessment. Women should be offered an early ultrasound scan between 10 to 13 plus 6 weeks of gestation to determine the gestation age and to detect the multiple pregnancy. This will ensure consistency of the gestational age assessment and reduce the incidence of induction of labor for prolonged pregnancy. Now, crown run length measurement should be made to determine the gestation age. If CRL is above 84 mm, the gestation age should be estimated using head circumference. This is very important that if CRL is more above 84 mm, then gestation age should be estimated using the head circumference. Now, what life self consideration should be told to the woman working during pregnancy? Pregnant women should be informed about their maternity rights and benefits, and the majority of the women can be reassured that it is safe to continue working during pregnancy. And further information about the possible occupational hazards during pregnancy is available here. And the woman occupation during pregnancy should be ascertained to identify those who are at increased risk through occupational exposure. Now, nutritional supplements. How much folic acid does a pregnant woman need? Okay, so pregnant women and those intended to become pregnant should be informed that dietary supplement with folic acid before consumption and throughout the first 12 weeks reduce the risk of child having neural tube defect. Okay, for example, anencephaly or spina bifida. The recommended dose is 400 microgram per day. Does a woman needs iron in the routine? Iron supplementation should not be offered routinely to all the pregnant women. It does not benefit the pregnant woman or a healthy baby and may have unpleasant side effects. So routinely, iron supplements should not be prescribed, but those women who are at risk of iron deficiency, we should prescribe them even when their HP is within the normal range. What is the recommendation about the vitamin A? Okay, pregnant women should be informed that vitamin A supplementation intake above 700 microgram might be teratogenic and should therefore be avoided. Pregnant women should be informed that the liver and liver product may also contain high level of vitamin A, and therefore consumption of these products should be avoided. Now, what is the recommendation about vitamin D? All the women should be informed that booking appointment about the importance for their own and the baby's health. for maintaining adequate vitamin D stores during pregnancy and whilst breastfeeding. In order to achieve this, women should be advised to take vitamin D supplements 10 microgram of vitamin D per day as found in the Health Start multivitamin supplements. Women who are not eligible for Health Start benefits should be advised where they can buy supplements. Which women are at increased risk of vitamin deficiency, particular care should be taken to inquire as to whether women at greater risk of vitamin risk are forming advice to take their daily supplements. And these includes women with a darker skin and women who have limited exposure to light, as I've explained, and women confined for the long period. And food acquired infection, women pregnant women should be offered information on how to reduce the risk of listeriosis. How to reduce the risk of listeriosis? By drinking only pasteurized or UHT milk and not eating ripened soft cheese such as Camembert, Barry, and Blue Wine cheese. Okay, and there is no risk with a hard cheese such as cheddar or cottage cheese and processed cheese. Okay. And not eating paid of any sort, including vegetables, not eating uncooked or undercooked or ready prepared meals. Okay. And so in that way, the risk of listeriosis can be reduced. How to reduce the risk of salmonellosis? By avoiding the raw or partially cooked eggs or food that may contain them, such as mayonnaise. Okay. And avoiding the raw or particularly cooked meat, especially poultry. Partially cooked meat or raw meat should be avoided. Prescribed medication. Few medicines have been established as safe to the pregnancy. Prescription medication should be used with as little as possible during pregnancy and should be limited to circumstances in which the benefit outweighs the risk. Over-the-counter medication. Pregnant women should be informed that the few over-the-counter medications have been established as being safe to take in pregnancy. Over-the-counter medicine should be used as little as possible during pregnancy. Complementary therapy. Women should be informed that few complementary therapies have been established as being safe and effective during pregnancy, and women should not assume that such therapies are safe and should be used as little as possible during pregnancy. Exercise during pregnancy. Pregnant women should be informed that beginning or continuing a moderate course of exercise during pregnancy is not associated with an adverse outcome. Okay, so moderate exercises can be established. Okay, pregnant women should be informed of the potential dangers of the certain activities, for example, contact sports, high impact sports, vigorous racket sports that may involve the risk of abdominal trauma, fall, or excessive joint stress, as scuba diving, which may result in fetal birth defect and fetal decompression disease. Sexual intercourse in pregnancy. Pregnant women should be informed that the sexual intercourse in pregnancy is not known to be associated with any adverse outcome. Okay. Smoking in pregnancy. At first contact with a woman, her smoking status provide information about the risk of the smoking to the unborn child and hazards of the exposure to the secondhand smoke. Address any concern she and her partner or her family may have about the stopping smoking. Pregnant women should be informed about the specific risk of the smoking during pregnancy, such as the risk of having baby with a low birth weight and preterm birth. Offer personal information, advice and supports on how to stop smoking and monitor smoking status, and offer smoking cessation advice and discuss the risk and benefits of the nicotine replacement therapy with a pregnant woman who smoke, particularly those who do not wish to accept. Offer help from NHS Stop Smoking Service. Advise the woman using nicotine patch to remove from going to bed. And now cannabis used in pregnancy. The direct effect of cannabis on the baby, on the fetus, are uncertain but may be harmful. Cannabis use is associated with smoking, which is known to be harmful. Therefore, women should be discouraged from using cannabis during pregnancy. Air travel during pregnancy. Pregnant women should be informed that long-haul air travel is associated with increased risk of venous thromboembolism, although whether or not there is additional risk during pregnancy is uncertain. In general population, wearing correctly fitted compression stocking is effective at reducing the risk. And car travel during pregnancy. Pregnant women should be informed about the correct use of the seat belt, that is 3-point seat belt above and below the bum, and not over it. And traveling abroad during the pregnancy. Pregnant women should be informed that if they are planning to travel abroad, they should discuss considerations such as flying, vaccination and travel insurance with their midwife or or doctor. Management of the common symptoms of pregnancy, nausea and vomiting. Women should inform that most of the cases of nausea and vomiting in pregnancy will resolve spontaneously by 16 to 12 weeks. And the nausea and vomiting are not usually associated with a poor pregnancy outcome. And if the woman requests or would like to consider treatment, the following intervention appears to be effective at reducing symptoms. Certain non-pharmacological interventions such as ginger and P6 wrist acupressure. Wrist acupressure P6. This is a specific technique. You can check it on the YouTube or somewhere else. And second is pharmacological intervention in the form of antihistamine. Okay, information about all form of the health should be given. Now, heartburn. Women who present with the symptoms of the heartburn in the pregnancy should be offered information regarding the lifestyle and dietary modification. And antacid may be offered to the woman whose heartburn remains troublesome despite lifestyle and diet modification. Constipation. Women who presents with a constipation pregnancy should be offered information regarding the diet modifications such as bran or wheat fiber supplementation. Hemorrhoids. In the absence of evidence of the effectiveness of this treatments for hemorrhoids in pregnancy, women should be offered information concerning the diet modification. If the clinical symptoms remain troublesome, standard hemorrhoid cream should be considered. Varicose veins. Women should be informed that the varicose veins are common symptoms of pregnancy and that will not cause harm, and that compression stocking can improve the symptoms but will not prevent the varicose vein from emerging. Now, vaginal discharge. Women should be informed that increase in vaginal discharge is a common physiological change that occurs during pregnancy. If it is associated with age, soreness or offensive smell or pain on passing urine, there may be an ineffective cause and investigation should be considered. Okay, a 1 week course of the topical imidazole is an effective treatment and should be considered for vaginal candidiasis infection in pregnant women. The effectiveness and safety of the oral treatment for vaginal candidiasis in pregnancy are uncertain, and these treatments should not be offered. Backache. Now, women should be informed that exercising in the water, massage therapy, and the group or individual back care classes might help to ease the backache during pregnancy. Clinical examination during pregnancy. Measurement of the weight and body mass index, maternal weight and height should be measured at the booking appointment, and the woman's body mass index should be calculated. Repeated weighing during pregnancy should be confined to the circumstances in which the clinical management is likely to influence the breast examination. Routine breast examination during antenatal care is not recommended for promotion of the postnatal breastfeeding. Pelvic examination routine antenatal pelvic examination does not accurately assess the gestational age, nor does it accurately predict the preterm birth or cephalopelvic disproportion if it is not recommended. And the pelvic genital female genital mutilation, pregnant women who have had the female genital mutilation should be identified in early antenatal care, and antenatal examination will then allow the planning of the intrapartum care. Domestic violence. As the healthcare professionals, we need to be alert to the symptoms or sign of domestic violence, and the woman should be given opportunity to disclose domestic violence in an environment in which they feel secure. Prediction, detection, and initial management of the mental disorder. Okay, that should be done, and screening for hematological condition like anemia. Okay, and pregnant women should be offered testing at the booking at 28 weeks, and HB level should be at HB level outside the UK normal range of pregnancy, that is 11 per 100 ml at first contact and 105 per 100 ml at 28 weeks should be investigated, and iron supplementation considered if indicated. And blood grouping and red cell alloantibodies. Women should be offered testing for the blood group and rhesus D status in early pregnancy. It is recommended that routine antenatal and TD prophylaxis is offered to all non-sensitized women who are rhesus D negative. Women should be screened for atypical red cell antibodies in the pregnancy and at 28 weeks regardless of their RHD status. Pregnant women with a clinical significant atypical red cell alloantibodies should be offered referral to the specialist center for further investigation and advice on subsequent antenatal management. If the pregnant woman is rhesus negative, consideration should be given to offer partner testing to determine whether the administration of antibody prophylaxis is necessary. Screening for hemoglobinopathy. Okay, preconception counseling and carrier testing should be available to all women who are identified as being at high risk of hemoglobinopathies using the family origin questionnaire and information about the screening for sickle cell disease and thalassemia, including the carrier status and implication for these, should be given to the pregnant woman at first contact with the healthcare professionals. A screening for sickle cell disease and thalassemia should be offered to all women as early as possible in early pregnancy, by ideally by 10 weeks. The type of the screening depends upon the prevalence and can be carried out in either primary or secondary care. Where the prevalence of sickle cell disease is high, fetal prevalence above 1.5 cases per 10,000, laboratory investigation should be offered to all women to identify carriers of the sickle cell disease or thalassemia. Okay, and family origin questionnaire should be given to some women. Okay, screening for fetal anomalies, we have to do an anomaly scan at 18 to 20 weeks, and if the purpose of the scan is to identify fetal anomalies and to allow the reproductive choices and prevent to prepare for any disability and manage birth in specialist care and intrauterine therapy. Women should be informed of the limitation of the routine ultrasound screening and that detection rate vary by the type of fetal anomaly. And if anomaly is detected during the anomaly scan, pregnant women should be offered the finding to enable them to make informed choices as to whether they wish to continue with the pregnancy or have termination of pregnancy. Fetal echocardiography involving the fourth chamber view of the fetal heart and outflow is recommended as a part of the routine anomaly scan. Routine screening for cardiac anomalies, including knuckle translucency, is not recommended. And when routine ultrasound screening is performed to detect the fetal neural tube defect, alpha fetal protein testing is not required. Now, participation in the regional congenital anomaly register is strongly recommended. Now, screening for the Down syndrome. All the pregnant women should be offered screening for the Down syndrome, and women should understand that it is their choice to embark on the screening for the Down syndrome. And screening for the Down syndrome should be performed at the end of the first trimester, but provision should be made to allow later screening for the woman booking late in pregnancy. The combined test beta HCG pregnancy protein A should be offered to screen the Down syndrome between 11 to 13 plus 6 weeks. For the women who book late in pregnancy, the most clinically and cost-effective serum screening test should be offered between 11 and 20 weeks. And when it is not possible to measure the knuckle translucency owing to fetal position or body mass index, women should be offered screening test between 15 to 20 weeks. Information about the screening for Down syndrome should be given to the pregnant woman at first contact with a healthcare professional. And the screening pathway for both screen positive and screen negative results should be given. The decision that needs to be made at each point along the pathway and their consequences. And the fact that screening does not provide a definitive diagnosis and full explanation. The risk score obtained following the testing, information about the chorionic venous sampling and amniocentesis, the balanced and accurate information about the Down syndrome screening. If the pregnant woman receives screen positive results for Down syndrome, she should have rapid access to appropriate counseling by the trained staff. And the routine anomaly scan should not be routinely used for the Down syndrome screening using the soft marker. How the knuckle fold thickness problem referred to the fetal medicine specialist. The presence of an increased knuckle fold, 6 mm or above, or 2 or more soft markers of the routine anomaly scan should prompt referral to fetal specialist or an appropriate healthcare professional. Screening for infection, we have to do screening for asymptomatic bacteriuria, asymptomatic bacterial vaginosis, and chlamydia trachomatis, cytomegalovirus. Although the available evidence does not support the routine cytomegalovirus screening in pregnant women, and it should not be offered. Hepatitis B screening, serological screening for hepatitis B should be offered to the pregnant woman, and hepatitis C pregnant women should not be offered routine hepatitis C screening. HIV pregnant women should be offered HIV infection early in the HIV screening should be done. Rubella, the recommended recommendation has been withdrawn, and rubella pregnant women should not be offered routine GBS screening. And syphilis screening for the syphilis should be offered to all pregnant women at early stage in the antenatal care, because treatment of syphilis is beneficial to the woman and the baby. Toxoplasmosis, routine antenatal screening for toxoplasmosis should not be offered. Okay, and although we have to give information that she should wash the hands, thoroughly wash the fruits, and avoid the raw meat and wearing gloves, thoroughly hand wash before handling with the soil, avoid cat feces. Okay, now screening for the clinical conditions in accordance with the NICE guideline and preeclampsia at each blood pressure measurement and urine analysis from protein should be carried out at each antenatal visits. And what are the risk factors for preeclampsia? The risk factor includes age more than 14, nearly parity, pregnancy interval of more than 10 years, family history of preeclampsia, previous history of preeclampsia, body mass index of 30 kg per mole, pre-existing vascular disease such as hypertension, pre-existing renal disease, multiple pregnancy. Okay, what is the correct method of using the blood pressure? Okay, first of all, remove the clothing and sit in relaxed position. Use the cuff of appropriate size. Inflate the cuff to 20 to 30 above the palpated systolic blood pressure and lower the columns down slowly by 22 mm per second per beat and read the blood pressure to nearest 2 mm of millimeter of mercury and measure the systolic pressure as disappearance of the sound. And hypertension in which there is a single diastolic pressure of the 110 millimeter mercury or two consecutive reading of 90 millimeter mercury at 4 hours apart and or significant proteinuria plus 1 should prompt increased seriousness. If systolic blood pressure above 160 millimeter on two or more consecutive reading at least 4 hours apart, treatment should be considered. All the pregnant women should be made aware of the needs to seek immediate advice from healthcare professional if they experience a symptom of headache, abdominal pain, and severe pain just below the rib and vomiting and sudden swelling of the face. Okay. And preterm placenta previa, we have to go to their own guideline, fetal growth and well-being. Some physical fundal height should be measured at each antenatal appointment from 24 weeks of gestation. Ultrasound for estimation of fetal size and unsuspected large for gestation age. Unborn baby should be undertaken in the low-risk population routine. Doppler screening should not be done in the low-risk, and fetal presentation should be assessed by abdominal palpation at 36 weeks or later, when the presentation is likely to influence the plan of the birth. Okay. Before 36 days, it is not recommended. It's not accurate and uncomfortable. Suspect fetal positioning. A malposition should be confirmed by ultrasound. And routine fetal, formal fetal movement counting should be offered. And auscultation of the fetal heart may confirm that the fetus is alive. Okay. And the evidence does not recommend the routine use of the CTG. The evidence does not support the routine use of the ultrasound scanner after 24 weeks of gestation, so therefore it should not be offered. Management in specific condition, pregnancy after 41 weeks prior to informal induction of labor, women should be offered vaginal examination. Okay, and women with uncomplicated pregnancy should be offered induction of labor beyond 41 weeks. From 42 weeks, women who decline induction of labor should be offered increased antenatal monitoring consisting at least twice weekly CTG and ultrasound estimation in maximum amniotic fluid depth. And breech presentation term. All the women who have uncomplicated singleton pregnancy at 36 weeks should be offered ECV. Exception include those women with a previous scar, abnormality, fetal compromise, ruptured membrane, vaginal bleeding, or other medical conditions. Okay, and where it is not possible to schedule an appointment for ECV at 37, it should be scheduled at 36 weeks. Okay, so this is all about the main points in this guideline.